I want to look at literary translation. I don't really look at literary translation as a category very much. It's not one of my favourite things to do. And as I went through it, it's sort of literary and film and popular culture translation. But types of translation that are not primarily there to convey information, okay, that have other kinds of functions. And I want to address that problem. Also because many of you have written on literary translation, because you're studying literature, one supposes. Okay? And I'm trying to go beyond, not just beyond translation, or not even beyond translation, but beyond the common, boring kinds of translation that we tend to assume. And I'll try to explain it through example. Now, here is a text.
It is from a fragment of the Odyssey. It's from Homer. Okay, well done. You got this is a clue to that. Okay, and the language is rather strange because pronouns, things are missing at the beginning.
And then went down to the ship, set keeled breakers, forth on the godly sea, and we set up mast and sail on that swart ship, bore sheep aboard her, and our bodies also heavy with weeping, and winds from sternward bore us out onward with bellying canvas. Circe's this craft, the trim-coifed goddess.
Does it sound Greek to you? Does it sound like normal English verse? Those who have a feel for normal English verse. No? Does it use rhyme? Not end rhyme. There's tons of internal rhyme, though, if you listen to it, and tons of alliteration. Okay? It's using a verse form that's actually from the 11th century, 11th, 12th century in Anglo-Saxon poetics, when the verse still counted syllables, as it does in most European languages still, which is why the reader gives equal measure to each syllable, and the verse relies on internal rhyme and a lot of alliteration. So you can get it anywhere there. Boar, sheep, a border, and our bodies. It's boar, boar, boar. It sounds like the sheep going onto the ship, if you like. Heavy with weeping and winds from sternward, whir, 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 whir. This is a different kind of verse from that which we're commonly used to. Any idea who did it? Okay. It's from Ezra Pound, American poet and political renegade. It's from his call to make literature new. He used translations a lot in his work, and this is the first of his cantos. The cantos is a huge work that took most of his life, and this is the beginning of it. Normally, in Homeric translations, you begin with an invocation of the muses. Sing to me, muse, okay? He doesn't. He begins from a voyage, and this is the very beginning, and went down to the ship. What does that tell you? And went down to the ship. Can that be the beginning of a big book? Not usually. It's consciously presenting a fragment. Okay, that I've got this fragment out. Something has happened beforehand because we assume and there's a previous action and the subject is omitted because the subject must have been named in what's there prior. So there's a conscious fragmentation of it and then the conscious use of an old English verse form to represent an even more ancient Greek text. The song is very close to the Seafarer and other poems of that period that exist in English because the English were a people of the sea, and that has been captured there. What you find, I think, in the text is a mapping of the Homeric experience of the voyage onto the particularly English language experience of the voyage expressed in the verse form. Is there any word you don't recognize there?
first one and the last line.
Sorry?
Circe?
Circe is the name of a Greek god. Okay. Anything else?
Coiffed.
Sorry?
Coiffed
is just the coiffure with the hair, her hairdo.
Oh.
She's got her hair.
Swart?
Yeah. That's the one I always remember. This swart ship. Can you guess what it means?
Laden.
Sorry?
Heavenly laden.
Heavenly laden. Why? Elizabeth, you can guess what swart means. And you should guess what it means. Black. Black. It comes from the Dutch and the German. Schwarz, zwart, whatever. You might recognize swarthy. A swarthy complexion is dark. Okay. Swart, what is that word doing there? I actually did an engram. You know you can do engrams for words and compare them. It was actually quite common around the period when Pound was writing this canto. It had its sort of literary resurgence, but it really comes from a long way back. And it's an archaism, a recognizable archaism in English. What interests me is that text sort of conveys something new about a very old text by using old resources that are in the history of the English language. It does seem to me to be using old things to say things about old things, but making it new. And further on in the canto, we learn that Pound is in fact not translating from Greek, he's translating from a 16th century Latin translation by an Italian that he happened to find in the booksellers, among the bookshops along the Seine in Paris. Found this old translation, and he's working from that. Okay. All right, I'm interested in that kind of experience and that doing things with translation that are other than just translating the text as we find it, doing a straight translation, which is what we've been doing. You can do other things, and I'm interested in what those other things might be. Here's why. This is a mental exercise, okay? You're born into your first language, your L1. This is language 1.5. You go to school and you learn to write it. Or you're born into a variety or a dialect and you go to school and learn the standard version. Okay, when I went to school, we learned how to not speak Australian English and how to speak British English. That's how old I am. Okay. That's changed. If you're lucky, you learn L2, but you might have L2 at home as well. Many of us were brought up in bilingual families. And you can pick up another language because all languages are related. So, for example, if I pick up French and Spanish, I get Catalan. It's in between the two. That was free. And Italian's just one step on. And so you get chains of languages. You buy them in packets, as many of you know. Or you might learn an L3 as well. So many of us would be somewhere there. And most translators are. The people who translate sort of have a profile, something like that. Okay, you still have your L1, but you've got other things around it. You might have two L1s, that's also possible. And we think we're pretty good, because we can work between a lot of languages. The problem is this. In Melbourne, there's about 250 languages spoken at home, in people's homes, around the table, when they eat, 250. So we think we're pretty good with our 5 or 6 or whatever languages. We're just that percentage of it. We don't know about the rest of these languages and what's happening there. We don't know those languages. Okay? And then if you pick up the 6,000 or so languages in the world, 6,000 is a conservative estimate, that's how much we know about it. We're there. There's all that blank space out there that we don't know about. And then, as I mentioned last week, if you go back to the beginning of language, over 350,000 years, where are we? I think I did put a dot there, but it disappeared. Okay. I'm trying to illustrate to you that our knowledge of languages is just a small part of the entire experience that is in human languages. And if you're interested in the humanities and you're interested in what it is to be human and you're trying to find out something about it, everything that's come from that black gray space out there, everything that we think we know about it, or that we think we don't know about it, everything that we've figured of that and configured or attributed or misattributed, all of that has come to us through translation. Now, it seems to me that the great risk is not so much just ignoring that space, but receiving information that doesn't arouse our curiosity, that doesn't invite us to go out and find more. And that's what I'm interested in here. I'll present it through the work of a German sociologist called Niklas Luhmann. Luhmann has a wonderful theory for people who work with languages and linguistics because he sees a social system as a system of pure communication. Everything in the system is just pure communication. But then he has a problem when he deals with how it's different systems, English language, Chinese language, different systems if you like, Australian culture, Chinese culture, different systems. How do they communicate if the system itself is only communication? And Luhmann says, well, actually, there is no communication between different systems. And instead of communication, he uses the term irritation. The systems just irritate each other. And I've been worried about this great theory of society that doesn't help us in translation studies because we deal precisely with communication between systems. And I asked myself, why does Luhmann not call it communication? What is it? What's this irritation? I looked it up in German. The German word is Irritation. So that doesn't help me at all. He just used an English term in German. Okay? And he describes it through a series of metaphors, but I'll just take you through this struggle to understand what's going on between systems. It generates resonance to events in the environment. It's as if these systems touch each other, and that's an event. And then, boing, there's these shock waves that go through. It's not communication, it's just, well, something's happened there. Okay? A bit further on, irritation, it's not just normal information in the sense of understanding something that is solid and sure in the world. This irritation incorporates a deviation from what's already known. Okay, it irritates me because I don't know about it already, and I'm interested in it. And that in dealing with it, I'm going to restructure in part my own system. We know this as well, that the context between social systems, if they are long and persistent and important enough, have consequences within the systems. He goes further when he relates irritation to part of aesthetic experience. And this is not particularly original either, that the attraction of opposites or the unknown or the foreign should be part of aesthetic pleasure. But he does talk about this taking delight in it, or taking delight in the provocation, to a Greek term for wonder and marvel. And then he refers back to a concept called admiratio, which is strange in Latin. So I went chasing these things up. The Greek didn't lead very far, but the admiratio did. I don't know if you can understand why I'm doing this. I'm interested in translation as producing this kind of irritation, and what do I want it to do? I'm just thinking in the ideal case. What kinds of translations would I like to see happen? And I got to Descartes, who is certainly not one of my favorite philosophers, ever. Not somebody I would normally cite. But this passage is intriguing. When, upon first encounter, an object surprises us, and we esteem it new or quite different from whatever we knew before, or from what we supposed it should be, then we admire it and we are astonished by it. Okay, this is close to the irritation kind of thing. Why do we have translations? Because it's something we don't have or we don't know about already. Okay. And given that this can happen before we know whether this object suits us or not, nous est convenable, well, suits us or not, it's convenient or appropriate for us, I think admiration is the first of all passions. It has no opposite. You know, love and hate are opposite, and all of Descartes' subsequent passions have their opposites. But he says admiration, no, it doesn't have an opposite. Because if the object has nothing that surprises us, we are not moved by it, and we observe it without passion. So this admiration, admiratio, is something beyond just looking at an object and observing it. It's not just, oh yes, I can see China up there. That's fine, okay. It says, hey, there's something there I want to know about, or I don't want to know about. It's even before that. It's before wow. It's like, whoa, wait a minute. There's something there. I'm going to see if it's good or bad. Yeah. So I'm against these theories of intercultural communication, or indeed of translation, that say, oh, it'll teach us this universal understanding, or to like each other, or to get on with each other. No, we don't get on with each other. There's lots of conflict involved. There's lots of struggle, and lots of struggle with self-identity in relation to the other. But prior to that, to set it in movement, you need something there to say, whoa, I'm going to look at this. I figure it out. Something like perhaps what Pound was doing in that poem, which is radically different from what we would expect at the beginning of a major work of American literature, or indeed a translation from Homer. Quite a few other people are thinking about this problem in sort of the same way I am now. Many of them refer to Alain Badiou, who was a radical Marxist back from the days of radical Marxism. But Badiou works on the event, and he talks about the aesthetics of the event. And he's interested in the way people can believe in things without offering any proof. And he thinks that what is missing in the world is this possibility of getting people motivated without going through scientific or empirical proofs. We can't prove that Marxism will solve all the world's problems. Doesn't matter. Believe in it, okay? There's no proof of the event, nor is the event a proof. He worked on St. Paul, amazingly enough, analyzing St. Paul's letters, which is what we have, and St. Paul's appeal to the Christian communities in the early church, my grace is sufficient to you. I cannot prove that Christ has been resurrected, but you will believe it, and that belief will be enough. And it worked. That's the amazing thing, okay? That this aesthetics of the event can work and get people to believe it. Now, I like that, because I think the translations, if they're good, I think Pound's translation especially, creates events. The hearing reading it for me is an event. And you say, well, there's something there I'm interested in. I'm not going to go all the way, though, with that mode of thought, because there are events and there are events. And although I'm talking about something prior to deciding if it's good or bad, there are plenty of big-scale events, like the Nuremberg rallies of the Nazi Party, that didn't lead to very positive cultural consequences. And so I want to put the brakes on that logic of getting the translations to work as this major event that will get people to forget about reason or forget about whether it is convenable, whether it's appropriate or not. I don't want to go too far there. I want to talk about that first moment of interest, and that's what I think translation should be doing, should be cultivating, without excluding the rest. It sets people off on a voyage of discovery into that grey space with which they will use all their reason and all care. I'm looking for something that creates an event prior to the segmentation of different audiences. if possible, an event should bring people together to participate in it. I'm interested in events that do require the text. I'm not interested in some people. Edwin Gensler, one of you mentioned Gensler's work. He goes beyond translation. He says translation is always transcreation. There's always recreation, and we should study all of that. I'm not really interested in that here. You know, if you see West Side Story, it is Romeo and Juliet, and Shakespeare took his study, his play, from previous stories. Okay, there's always this reworking. I'm not interested in that. I'm interested in stuff that really does need the text, or The Lion King, if you're into that, is Hamlet. Okay, no, that's recreation, that's fine. I'm interested in translation in a narrower sense that is going to tell us about that gray space, not just about something we're producing for our own selves now. I need a kind of event that opens to the space of the other. Now, it seems to me that if I'm looking for things like that, I can formulate in my mind what I would like translation to do in that space. There are examples all around us. And the rest of this talk, I just want to give you some examples of stuff that I think is interesting and might fulfill these expectations. And they're not major mysteries. You might have seen the film 300, which makes human characters look like animated cartoon characters, or comics, more the level of comic. But there's a whole language level there at work. For example, they're telling us about the Battle of Thermopylae, when the Greeks stopped a huge army of Persians advancing because they had to come through the narrow gates, okay, a pass. But in the film, it's called the Hot Gates Battle. And we're watching this and go, wow, now I know why it's called Thermopylae. I can see thermal, hot, polite must mean the gates. Oh, I've learned something about Greek. Okay, it's a very minor thing. What is it? It's a compositional translation of the Greek proper name. But I'd been hearing about the Battle of Thermopylae for ages. I did it in social studies in primary school. It's always been there. And suddenly I said, oh, it's different. It's a little bit. It's just, wait a minute. Whoa. Let me find out more. What's going on here? Other stuff, Spartacus. You can tell I spent too long watching rubbish films and television. There's this, it's a basically Australian-made television series of Spartacus, but there are characters and moments there when characters are speaking English with Latin syntax, such as open mouth and lend voice to tongues, means speak to me. Okay, but he doesn't say speak to me, he says open mouth and lend voice to tongues. What is going on here? We've got the Latin and the English crashed together, and we can understand what's going on. Why? Because it's a filmic text. You've got the context. But, you know, this guy's speaking Latin. This is Pontius Pilate speaking. And the film is in Latin and Aramaic and Hebrew. And I think it's great. I don't understand. I'm relying on the subtitles. And the subtitles here do not follow the Latin. But I've got the voice and I've got the audiovisual content which conveys all the foreignness. So even though the subtitles in this film are fairly domesticated, just straight, you know, behold the man, could be a biblical text, behold. You know, the foreignness is there because I can hear the voice going on in the other language. It's also quite successful. Until Wolf Warrior 2 came along and beat it as the highest grossing for a non-English language film. Another film by Mel Gibson as director is in Mayan, but it was distributed by Disney, using subtitles all the way through as well, playing with the foreigners. These are of interest to me, not the subtitles as such, but the interplay between the foreignness of having that language there with its illusion of authenticity and the subtitles giving us a way into that. Let me follow through, just other examples. for various reasons, a lot of my work goes back to Herodotus, a Greek historian. And this is just two translations of the same passage from Herodotus. I'll read the first. Then after that, for the omens to be favorable for the Spartiates, when they were making sacrifices for themselves, was not possible. And that for a long time was theirs. Any guesses? Does this sound good to you? What could it be? No, any good, no. I just thought it sounds like machine translation. It's got that sort of syntactic literalism. Whereas the classic straight translation is, after this event, it was not possible for the Spartiates when they sacrificed to obtain certain omens. This was the case with them for a long time. There's also a syntactic ambiguity there, but I take it that this is much more understandable than that. I'd hope you'd agree. Okay. What's interesting is that it's not a machine translation. This is an extremely literal translation done by Felderbaum and available online for free. And I used it a lot to try to follow what's happening in the Greek text. Extremely literal, a crib, if you like, for people who are trying to get through ancient Greek. Whereas this is Macaulay, 1890, which is a domesticating version. What's interesting for me is that these days, because of electronic publication, I can immediately get both those versions online and about 12 more. That I'm not stuck to one translation. Electronic publication means we can get this translation and that one and that one and that one, and we can make sense of them as much as we like. And we can get the Greek if we want to struggle through it, with all the paraphernalia that will help us do it. Okay, that there is a possibility these days of multiple translation, and it becomes possible to go back to extreme literalism, pedagogical literalism, which has its purpose. And the user is not locked into one reading or another. I go back to Pound. This is a rather different strategy. Can you read that? The jeweled stairs grieve. Oh, you people who know Chinese can see it over there. That's the poem in Chinese. But I'm told the Chinese talks about jade rather than jewels. However, okay. What's interesting is that, okay, the jeweled steps are already quite white with dew. It is so late that the dew soaks my gauze stockings, and I let down the crystal curtain and watch the moon through the clear autumn, which, as such, sounds rather sweet, but Pound has added a long explanation of what's going on, which interprets the text and makes it meaningful. What's interesting here is that the translation comes with the notes, and the notes make the translation meaningful, and I think it's quite successful. What's happening in this translation? Well, we get a straight translation, more or less, and an explanation which makes it understandable. Why should we be limited to just giving one version, just giving the translation, without this paratext, or co-text, if you like? That logic of adding to a not doing just a translation, but doing translation with notes, with a preface, with all this paraphernalia that we can use, also helps to create an event. And the person I know who does most, or has done most in this respect, is Spivak, Gayatri Spivak. This is from a translation of a Bengali woman author. And what's surprising is, that I don't know if you can see it there, but it's called Breast Stories, and Mahasweta Devi, the author's name is there in big print, and underneath there you've got the name of the translator. But when you get into the actual book, 76 of 176 pages are the translation, which means, 75. So it means there's 101 pages of the translator talking about the translation. There's an interview with the author. There's an introduction, there are essays on the author, and most of that has been brought from Spivak's previous publications. But the book has more explanation than translation. And yet it works. It creates an event. Spivak uses her academic prestige in the American university system to attract attention to this Bengali writer. She started her translation career on working on Jacques Derrida of Grammatology, one of the great foundational texts of post-structuralism. And what's amazing there is that the introduction is incredibly long, I think 70 pages or so. She's going to tell us about the text and about herself and her translating a lot. And then the end of the introduction has this quite wonderful passage. The first part of this book, writing before the letter, sketches in broad outlines. Now I insert my text within his and move you on, situating here a theoretical matrix. It indicates certain significant historical moments and presupposes my name, certain historical concepts. Sorry, Gayatri Chakravorty Spivak. What she's doing is, she's writing her introduction, and then the actual translation starts on the next page. Over here, that's the actual translation of the text, and she inserts the two together. But the translator's preface and the actual translation overlap in this liminal space, which I think is rather clever. Instead of this separation of the translator's voice from the translated text, we have a forced coming together of those two. Okay, things can be done. That's what I'm trying to get to. Another person who wants to do things to make it new or make it different is Clive Scott. Clive Scott, I cited when I did my doctoral thesis many years ago as an expert on French verse. He's just an expert on the history of verse forms, 19th to 20th century. But he's also, a translator. He's translating this poem, which is about arriving at a train station in the English countryside. Yes, I remember Adenstrop, the name because one afternoon of heat, the express train drew up there unwantingly. It was late June. Very, very English. Now, his translation is into English. That's one of it. I put the text on LMS. He goes through various translations of this text into English, and his point of departure is that a translation is always firstly a reading. So he has his personal reading of this text in English, and then he looks around for ways to express the values of his reading. And he says, well, in the history of verse, we have lots of typographic possibilities these days. We went through concrete poetry, and so he's put it in the shape of a big dragonfly, because he imagines it's summer and there are dragonflies around there. Can you see the dragonfly in the verse? That's its wings. Okay. It might be a tree. If you want it to be a tree, it could be a tree as well. Okay. And then as he goes on, he says, well, yes, and I imagine around this train station in summer there are birds singing. And I'll indicate the names of the birds, there's some of them there, in various languages, and then the sounds that the bird makes. And so the translation into English builds up on his various personal associations with this text. You can translate from English into English. And the final version, actually, this is it, it's on the front cover of his book. He says, well, you know, there could be a dance as well, and so we've got a choreography written on top of his translation of the text. I find this stuff really intriguing. There's one thing that bothers me, though, is that Clive Scott's working on the printed page, and yet he wants to talk about a personal reading. And for me, a personal reading is voice. You get a text, and if I read it out loud, I'll read it one way. You'll all read it a different way. We all have our personal readings. But the voice is what can convey that more, I suspect, than this. It sort of gets in the way of understanding the text. I'm not really convinced. I'm intrigued by what he's doing, but it's not. It just overlooks what's happening. The people are not really communicating on printed pages very much. They're communicating through electronic text and audiovisual media. This is my last example, I think. Thank you for bearing with me so far. With a colleague in Spain, for the past few years, we have poetry translation competitions. We get a text, and I translate it, and he translates it, and we present our two translations and see who wins. Sometimes he wins, sometimes I win. Okay. We were translating this poem by Machado. Quite a few of you had Spanish, so you might be able to follow that. Or you might have heard of it. It's very well known. Una tarde, parda y fría. It's a poem remembering the poet in school, looking out the window pane. It's raining. It's cold. It's gray. Parda means gray here. And he's talking about seeing Cain and Abel as a poster or an image in the classroom, and he relates that to the experience of schooling. Okay, Antonio Machado was the first to formulate the notion of las dos Españas, two Spains being confronted against each other. Spain was just about to go through a civil war while he was writing. Okay, hence Cain and Abel and that historical. Okay, I won't go into the text itself, but to translate it, it seemed to me that what I liked about the text was its rhyme scheme. Okay, got a very complex rhyme scheme. And then to put it into English, I needed the rhymes. So the first thing I did was get the rhymes, which are there. I said, well, these are the words I'm going to use. And I put those words there, and I just hang, then you fill in the rest. And you go back to the Spanish, you pick bits out and put them in. All right? And so you can do that. And I think that's my translation that I actually presented on the day. And I managed to get the rhyme, and I was happy with that. It's also the Spanish verse uses enjambment. That's when the syntactic unit doesn't correspond to the verse unit. So, una tarde, parda y frío de invierno. The invierno belongs to the sentence of the first line, but it comes on the next one. Okay? Which means that the rhyme is not falling at the end of the sentence. And you get this conflict, which I find quite pleasing, between the prose syntax and the verse syntax. It's quite common at beginning of late 19th century, beginning of early 20th century poetry in Spanish as well. So that enjambment I wanted to get, I did it in English in class on a cold gray winter afternoon, the day. Okay, the gray and day, that's the rhyme, but the syntax is doing other stuff. Okay, so I was quite happy with the formal qualities. But it was boring, as I'm sure you'll agree. That's only half the poem, but anyway. As I looked around, I saw, did people look at this before? They didn't. No, good. I found that this poem had lots and lots of versions in Spanish. And they're all on YouTube. Why? Because it's a poem about school. So people in school get the kids to do video projects on the poem. There's all this kids' work there. There's a little boy singing a song about it. And then there's a flamenco version of it, because the poem was written in Seville. Machado wrote later on in Soria in the north of Spain, but the poem was actually written while he was in Seville. So I just had all this wonderful stuff. I've got the flamenco, I've got the little kids, I've got the orchestra, I've got Cain and Abel fighting there. And I thought, well, instead of filling the rhyme with bits of language that I pick up from the poem, I could fill it with all this resonance, this cultural resonance that the poem already has in Spanish culture. and just pack that in and keep the rhyme. Do you see what I'm getting at? Okay, I'm playing on this resonance idea. I'm forgetting about the meaning, the information. I want to know what kinds of events have been happening around this poem and what kind of resonance that might continue with in English. Well, it may mean nothing to you, but it might also convey something of what that text does in Spanish culture at some level. Certainly not on the level of information, although you did get the rhyme. Okay. We're working in an age where a whole lot is being done on what the voice can do in electronic communication, but with respect to song. And I have a 13-year-old son, okay, so I listen to all this stuff on the radio. I have to when I'm driving around, he puts it on. And it's really interesting. So much is being done with the human voice that it seems absurd to have translation confined to the printed page and not using this stuff. This is just in case you haven't got a 13-year-old son, you don't have to listen to it.
Nano, man, that was a 24/7 special on the cable channel. So AJ went straight to the radio station the very next day. Hey, Fab, I'ma kill you. Lyrics coming at you with supersonic speed. Summon, I'm a doom, I'm a you, assuming I'm a human. What I gotta do to get it through to you? I'm superhuman, innovative, and I made a rubble so that anything you say is ricocheting off of me and it'll glue to you. I'm devastating, more than ever demonstrating how to give a motherfucking audience a feeling like it's levitating, never fading. And I know the haters are forever waiting for the day that they can say I fell off, they'll be celebrating. Cause I know the way to get them motivated. I make elevating music. You make elevator music.
Thank you. You make elevator music. He doesn't make elevator music. Well, not yet. I guess it'll get into elevators sooner or later. Okay, so much is being done there, and yet we think literary translation should have no connection with it at all. I really want more to be done in that respect. This is Eminem. It's great. It's great. It's actually lousy poetry if you look at it in detail, because it's driven by the rhyme, but the performance is wonderful. So my proposals are this. This is the way I'm thinking. These are proposals that you can reject if you like, but they might give you some ideas. That discourses on translation help attract attention to translations. If you want the translation to have an impact, to become an event, it is helpful to have translation studies or the prefaces on it or somebody talking about it. Okay, it can help do that. It creates more resonance. We have technologies. Cheap production and distribution make multiple translations available. That it's no longer just one translation. There are many that we can put out there. And our translation doesn't have to cover up any other. Also, I should have added there, anybody can do a translation. We're in a democratic age. We've got these online machine translation technologies that are getting better and better. Anybody can do a translation of some kind and get something out of that. And that should be part of the mix. Not the whole lot, but part of the mix. The cheap technologies, the same ones we've looked at, make collaborations possible. That we can do something with other people, with people who work on voice and videos, if you like. Or philologists can work with performance artists, if you like. audiovisual material can combine with linguistic. There's no reason just to stay with the printed page. Printed page, bookshops are closing down all over the world. Still going in Lygon Street, but people are communicating, they're getting that experience of otherness through audiovisual means. And at the same time, there's a lot of work on the most traditional of literary technologies, the human voice.